Analysis is a little bit different though. It has a different twist because we're not dealing with unassembled or disassembled products, or we're not dealing with incomplete or unfinished products. We're dealing with finished products. But the finished product can be either, let's say, 50 plastic steel. It can be 50-50, let's say, sugar coca. It can be 50-50 chemical A and chemical B, or it can be not 50-50, it can be 45-55 or more more or less, right? So what am I talking about here? I'm talking about here about the percentages of how much of the particular item is inside. But I'm not only talking about the numbers here, I'm also talking about the product. Because let me say this. So let's say instead of 50 plastic, 50 steel, we have 5% plastic and 95% steel. What's essential? What's more essential? Whatever the product is. Probably the steel is, right? Let me change that to... diamonds. Now what's more essential? So you cannot all put everything in one box, right? You have to look at quantity and you have to look at the product. In other words, you have to look at the big picture to determine. So there is really no one hard and fast definition for this essential character. One thing that is a must, is a requirement, you have to have it classifiable under two or more headings. It's a must. Composite good, you have to have two or more different materials which are in different headings, different components, and for goods put up in a retail sale, well, the sets that are put up in a retail sale, we already saw sets, the notion of sets in GRI 3A. The same type of requirements apply to GRI 3B. It must be for retail sale, it must be put together to reach the end consumer, and it must, each component within a set must be classifiable in two or more headings. So composite good, and I have the ash. It's an ashtray, I believe, as an example. We have the stand, which is made out of steel or metal, and we have the tray, which is made out of ceramic. One without another would not probably do because it is designed to be used as one. So this is what I mean by composite goods. Yes, you can possibly use the ball, but if the ball is shaped in a semi-round measure, it is really designed to fit that particular stand. So if it is designed to be used as one, you here have to determine what's more important for the ashtray. How do you classify? Do you classify it as an article of metal or ceramic? What type of things should you analyze? One of the requirements here in a composite good is that it must come together too, it must be imported together. It's not a set, because if it was a set, it would have been classifiable under two more headings, two different articles that have different uses. Remember, the set where they had a stationary, we had a stapler, and then we had a remover, and we had strips of staples. Here, it's really one thing. You put a stand, you put an ash tray on top, and you classify it, and you use it as one. What type of analysis here would you go through? Well, you cannot use GRI 3A because you have a part of metal and a part of ceramic. So you have a prohibition against the rule of relative specificity. So the next step would be to say, yes, because it is a metal, it is classifiable in one heading. It is also possible as an article of steel, let's say if it's steel, or brass, if it is copper, right? It can also be classified as a ceramic article. What's more important? Well, we have a tray which presumes utilitarian function. We put cigarettes in there. Without tray itself, the ceramic tray, it wouldn't do. We also have metal. If metal has it has a specific form, shape, it has these twisted legs, it is made for decoration, it really comes to as a huge, brings huge value added to the product. Plus, it has this spike on top. I'm not sure why, what it is for, but it obviously has some function. So what's more essential? What's more important? How do you know?
I guess
the first feeling is a tray, but then we have to, what other things we have to say? We have to say the price. What if it's not a ceramic, it's a cheap plastic tray. It's just a cheap plastic, right? So the tray is not ceramic, it's plastic, chapter 39, costs 5 cents, while this whole thing costs $5, the stand. Would your opinion change? And then you have marketing literature that says a specially designed tray, which is designed to stand out from other ash trays because it has legs. And you have legs in the foreground. Can I change your opinion then? Yeah? So obviously, we cannot answer this question based on information provided, right? But what we can conclude, and the whole idea of this discussion is not to pinpoint, okay, this is the classification, this classification. We are not there yet. We will get there, I promise. But we're not there yet. The whole idea is to say, to have an idea of what a composite good is, right? And why composite good is classifiable under the GRI 3B by virtue of having different materials, different components. Questions?
Could it be another option classified as furniture?
So the question is, can it be classifiable as furniture? Well, even if it is classifiable as furniture, it still wouldn't deprive it of GRI 3B. Because remember the chest example, the toolbox and the chest and the drawer. The furniture, so the question is, can we classify this as an ashtray as a furniture? All right, so let's see. Where is furniture classified at? Under what tariff? Under what chapter?
94.
And what is the criteria for the furniture to be classified in chapter 94? The criteria is the notes, right?
Yeah. the furniture, it won't apply the GRI 3? Not right.
Okay. So, note 2 of chapter 94 says the following. Articles, other than part, that I refer to heading 94.1 to 94.3, which is the furniture provisions, are to be classified in those headings only if, they should be bold, only if, jumps out, they are designed for placing on floor or the ground. Yes, there are cupboard. There is a cupboard, seats and bed exception, but this is a general rule. It looks like it is not standing on the ground. So, based on what I see, it looks like it stands on like a separate table. Based on what I see, it would be excluded by the chapter notes to the chapter 94 from being classifiable as furniture. But you can make an argument, you can extend the legs and just place it on the ground and say, no! I mean, I'm not sure how tall this is, right? If this is tall, we just don't have enough information, right? If we put it in a corner on the ground somewhere, then we can make the argument, right? But the goal here is to really drive down the composite good, not the classification in itself. Just a moment. Now, so we're done with the ashtray. can I move on to...
No need to spend the whole day.
No, we can do that. Ashtray is an interesting topic. So goods for retail sale, you know, as I said. So, I think we talked enough about it, but again, those pointers are very important. It must be packaged for retail directly to users. So you cannot have a wholesaler transaction where they take apart, let's say, in the case of the eraser and the marker, where they take them apart and they use it to achieve different marketing strategies, sell them separately, for example. Two different articles, two different headings at least. And another thing is for the set, it must be really designed to meet a single particular need or single specific activity. This is very important. It comes up on a customs broker exam too. The problem is that it is kind of a gray area rule. It's very difficult to say it is designed to use specific activity. So, for example, remember our example with the stationary set, where we have a stapler, we have a stapler remover, and we have a bunch of staples. All right, I can see that the staples and the stapler are designed to meet one specific activity, to put pages together. But the stapler remover, I can argue that it's designed to meet a different activity. The activity is not put pages together, but take pages apart. So stapler remover, by virtue of that analysis, is really not designed to fit a particular activity. What's the problem with that? The problem with that is, I suppose, to pinpoint the level of generality. Sometimes it's very obvious. Sometimes it may not be. Let me talk about one ruling. So this ruling, the ruling is the opinion expressed by Customs and Border Protection that a reference to a classification, to a marking, they are legally binding for that particular transaction. So when you come in, you present this ruling to Customs and Border Protection officer, And he must follow this because it comes from the national commodity import specialist. So this is a must requirement. Now, let's take a look at this example. So the ruling addresses the book and a blanket from China. And they refer to the book and the blanket as a set. So the question is it a set? So you have a blanket and you have a book. And look at the customs reasoning. Look at what he says, or she says.